For Creamer Media's Polity, I'm Samantha Herbst. Many would agree that post-apartheid South Africa finds itself in the midst of an identity crisis aggravated by what today's guest calls a worrying culture of acquiescence and silence. Media and communication specialist JJ Tabane joins me now to discuss his book, Let's Talk Frankly, in which he takes to task some of South Africa's most influential people about their role in our nation. Thank you for joining me, JJ.
Thank you, Zaman. Thank you for having me here.
Thank you. So let's get to it. Besides obviously needing to highlight the ills plaguing our nation, what was it that prompted you to write this book?
Well, basically two reasons. Firstly is the issue of accountability. I think that there is a lot of, if you like, a culture of not making ministers in particular to account, or politicians in general. So I thought I must write to these ministers and they must respond. They are obliged to respond. If you write to a minister, they respond. They are obliged to respond to you. You can raise issues. In the past, when there was a constituency system, that used to happen a lot, where even MPs themselves, when they go to their constituencies and find something that is not right, they would write to that minister and say, my constituency requires this or that service, or this or that was not done. That culture has disappeared, so I thought I'm going to start that culture. That's why most of the letters I've written even before were actually directed at ministers. But these letters in the book here are directed to a range of South Africans, from politicians to people in civil society, the church, and academics and people like that, but people with authority, people who can make a difference. So that's the first key reason. The second key reason I wrote the book is the culture of acquiescence and silence, particularly in political parties where there is an overemphasis on closing ranks and simply repeating after what we call the party line, instead of raising issues of moral conscience, issues of uprightness and doing things correctly. Because that closing of the ring is how things get hidden and things get swept under the carpet. So that's the second key reason to say I want to revive that. I want to encourage people to do what used to do in the past before the 94, where, you know, for every topic imaginable, you had position papers, people writing their views, circulating them out there, having a lot of debate. So those are the two key reasons why I wrote the book.
Okay, as you mentioned, Let's Talk Frankly comprises letters drafted to 22 of South Africa's biggest influences. And these include Thuli Madonsela, Patrice Motsepe, even Steve Hofmeyr.
Yeah.
So how did you come to the short list of people, and is there anybody in hindsight that you might have left out?
Well, there are lots of people I've left out, but this is only the first book. There'll be many others before I die. So there'll be volume 2, 3, probably up to volume 10 as the years go. So that's fine. Anybody who's been left out shouldn't feel particularly discriminated. So the issue of selection is really about people who have made some kind of an impact or in our body politic. We are selected really by inspiration. If somebody does something crazy, I would then write a letter. As I was saying earlier, there were over 100 of these letters, whereas the ones in the book are not a collection. They are all fresh material. So I looked at, you know, right at the top of political parties to say in the ANC, Gwenaël Mantashe should be one of the most influential people. In fact, I call him in there the sort of a prime minister, de facto prime minister of the country. The president's obviously influential. The Speaker of Parliament is influential. Leaders of key political parties. And then in the church, in business and civil society, I chose people who you could say are representative of those sectors in a way. So Ray McCauley, you know, he's not the best of religious leaders, but he's one of those who stand out, particularly in terms of the relationship with the current administration. In civil society unions, you look at Zwelinzima Mavavi, one of the most influential, so he takes the flag for those. Steve Hofmeyr just happened to be one of the crazy people who sort of is an example of how we shouldn't go about trying to build a new country. So I thought, let's write to him. You know, but as a proxy to all those who are still having nostalgia about the past. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's leaders of political parties, Musima Emani, Helen Zille, Julius Malema, and the likes. Then, of course, there's an additional letter there to a fictional person called the Signal Gem, whoever that is.
Whoever that may be, yes. Mm-hmm. As you mentioned, and one of your earlier letters was to Gwede Mantashe, and you highlight the threat of corruption in our government as one of the foremost issues plaguing our nation. So what would you say the South African government needs to do to start mitigating this issue?
Look, The issue is that there is no sense of consequence, excuse me, in dealing with corruption. So in 2009, the Auditor General came up with a list of about 2,000 civil servants who were basically doing business with themselves. So these people are directors, and they either have companies that where they are directors doing business with parts of the state where they are in charge, as bluntly as that. Others who are trying to be more sophisticated would have proxies. So, you know, they would take a girlfriend and make them a director and then give the person business. It's as good as doing business with yourself or your wife, girlfriend, mistress, whatever. Those people, none of those 2,000 people have been prosecuted as we speak. Right? So don't tell me that you are serious about corruption when there's an obvious case of these people. Auditor General has pointed at what they have done. Evidence is there. These matters were reported to Parliament to say here are people who have clearly been corrupt and are caught stealing public funds. So why don't you deal with them? Corruption Register, the NPA, doesn't have a handful of names if you go and look at it today, right? So clearly the key thing that needs to be done is a culture of consequence. So prosecute, go after these people who steal money, prosecute them. Two, in the ANC, NGC recently, there was a big discussion about the integrity committee and the fact that since it was appointed in Mangaung, it hasn't done much. But one of the key impediments was that it had to go through the NEC for it to do its work and for it to find certain people guilty or pronounce on certain things. And I think that has been removed. That is a very big step forward, where people will no longer be able to hide behind saying, I'm innocent until proven guilty and so on. If you are caught or your case is likely to embarrass the movement, step aside. And I think that's, we want to see whether that's going to happen. The recent case of John Block in the Northern Cape, where he was found guilty and then stepped aside, is just the way to go. But even that didn't stop the Secretary General saying, let's wait for a sentencing. That may be in months, you know. And I think that I'm happy that sense prevailed for a person like that to step aside. We make many other suggestions in there, but overall we're saying let's elevate the issue of integrity.
Right, yeah. Another overarching issue, which is a common thread throughout many of the chapters in the book, is the poor implementation of black economic empowerment in our country. Can you elaborate on this?
Yes, I think in the letter to Patrice Motsepe in particular, I use him as a representative of black business, because they obviously are very concerned about how BE affects them, but also how BE is an instrument of economic change. It's one of the best policies that this government has come up with, but it's been badly implemented and it's poorly monitored. If you would recall, there is something called the Employment Equity Commission. It's a commission that was looking at how corporations are adhering to affirmative action, for example. Every year they release a report. In fact, every company knows that every year they must give you a report about how far are they with employment equity and things like that. That doesn't make them improve, because over the last 21 years, you still have 60% of appointments and promotions being for white people, and black people are just left hanging. So they have not benefited much from affirmative action, which, by the way, is part of BE. One of the sections of BE has to do with employment equity. But the reason I mentioned the employment equity issue was that there's a structure that monitors that you do it. In BE, there isn't. BE Commission has been recently appointed. We're still waiting for a pronouncement about who's the BE Commissioner. But companies are not bothered, really, to report back on a regular basis and so on. If anything, companies are spending a lot of time hiring people who are helping them to crook the system. Just somebody sitting in a corner trying to figure out how to become level one without actually bothering to involve blacks in ownership and what have you. And of course, there's big debate now about the whole issue of what is called broad-based economic empowerment. We just grab a group of black people and just make them token ownership. And I explore that a lot in the letter to Peter Bruce, who somehow was justifying this terrible thing. When government was trying to say, we're going to revise this broad-based economic empowerment approach and balance it. Balance having actual entrepreneurs who are involved in the business, and interest groups who may take a share. That must be balanced, and you cannot do one at the expense of another. So the black economy, very important issue that I think will still feature in the future also in more letters to come.
Right. You also touch on the role of the media in South Africa, and you mentioned that there's a disconnect between the state and the fourth estate. How can we achieve that, bridging that gap again?
Well, I think the bridging the gap, and it's actually a part of my PhD that I'm looking at now, the relationship between the media and government, and how we can build those bridges. Simply to, for me, is to appreciate each other's differing but important roles. The media has a role as watchdog, firstly, but also a role to educate the nation, which is a big responsibility that can't just be left to government. Government has a role to empower citizens with information that would make sure that the citizens are able to take advantage of economic opportunities that are there in the country. And so these two are important. And so if there's an investment in the relationship between these two, if you like, competing forces, I think everyone could be able to then have the ability to implement their role better. I think that the constant, bickering, where government's always seeing media as biased, or media seeing government as, inefficient or whatever, by generalizing, is not helpful. Because, government hires more than 1 million people. You can't see out of all of those, they're all the same. Similarly, the media hires thousands of journalists. You can't dismiss them all at their go. So I think that there is space for that kind of, initiatives to bridge the gap that can happen going forward.
Speaking of media coverage, our headlines were this week dominated by the news of the nationwide university strikes. With this in mind, is there anything that you would have said differently in your letter to our Higher Education Minister, Bladen Zimande?
Not really. I've already said, if I publish that letter, and I'm thinking of publishing an extract of it, it already says everything that is required. The Minister of Higher Education happens to be the head of the Communist Party. And in my book, I argue that it's not particularly relevant, communism and so on. It's all outdated stuff. But if they could just get education right and pursue free education. The ANC already has a resolution as far back as 2013 saying that there must be a pursuit of free higher education. What you see now is the result of poor implementation, slow implementation, right? Because there is enough resources in the country, in these universities, and so on. If you look at the money that's been wasted on corruption, over 700 billion rand over the last 21 years wasted on corruption, 32 billion even recently wasted on what you call wasteful expenditure by municipalities. Nobody can tell me there are not enough resources to educate the nation. Because if you get that right, all these other problems will disappear in no time. Because everybody can stand on their own, they can go out there and be part of it. Active part in the economy, so I think the students have a point, and I hope that they will be listened to and they should not relent.
Great, thank you. As well, in your letter to Palo Jordan, you mentioned the death of debate in South Africa. So would you say that your book is a way of trying to initiate this debate again?
No, absolutely. That's, as I said at the beginning, one of the key reasons for writing the book was exactly to reignite debate. And I think it has stoked up debate, however you look at it. I mean, the fact that it's not just directed to one part of society, directed to everybody, so everyone will have a reaction. And that's really what I want to achieve. In launching the book, I didn't do a typical book launch where you just stand there and talk about the book, but rather a dialogue. In fact, we launched in 4 provinces where we conducted what we call a dialogue about the state of discourse in South Africa. And we're still going to do that in the remaining 5 provinces, where we get people talking about variety. It's less about what I say in the book, but it's more about my right to say it and encouraging others to also speak out about things that worry them. So, depending on which province we are in, the issues will be different. But I've been pleased at the way that people have responded in the debate. I didn't please everybody. I know that a couple of recipients were quite angry, but that's fine.
So of the recipients, what has the response been like?
Well, I've not gotten much response from the recipients directly. There's one or two who have sent people to come and sort of quiz me about why I've written and so on. I had Zwelin Zimavavi, who graciously agreed to come and debate with me in the book fair in Cape Town. It's one of the events that in fact, it was a sold-out event. People had to pay to come and listen to him, me and him debating. And he had read his letter. He only read it on the plane coming down to Cape Town. And he said he was wondering why he was invited, because he actually agrees with the death of debate. The way people, he makes the example about, you know, the fact that we had MPs voting about over this terrible report by the Minister of Police, saying there's nothing wrong with what is happening in Gandhi. And you've got people of conscience, assumedly, you know, elected by the people, but they all vote as sheep and say, no, this thing is fine. You know, he raised things of that nature, prompted by the letter. Of course, the letter is not kind to him at all, in terms of the sex scandal, for example, and things like that. But he was gracious. I didn't even have to raise those issues. He raised it himself to say, you know, you are right about what you said in the book. It was an old goal for me and so on. So I appreciated that. And seeing the Western Cape responded at the first launch of the book, which was at UWC, that the issues I'm raising there with Kwere Mandashi is things that are work in progress, and they will take them up with the, within the movement to debate them. So, you know, it's been a mixed bag. You know, some in the ANC were not happy with the letter to the president, saying it's not respectful. But, you know, my view is that nobody is above criticism,
sure,
whether you are the president or you are not.
Sure. And it seems to be provoking some sort of action on the part of the people that you're addressing these letters to. So
I would like to believe so, but you know, it's only me. But there are thousands of other people who are probably cleverer than I am, with more exposure to some of the subject matters. I mean, if you look at the letter to Motsoaledi, I'm quite sure there are medical students, medical PhDs out there who can write a far better letter to the minister to raise issues. But I raised from a point of view of just being an observer of our politics over the last couple of decades.
Mm. Well, let's hope some people do start responding and writing letters of their own.
Oh, absolutely.
JJ, lastly,
yes.
You have 3 degrees under your belt. Congratulations.
Yes.
And
yes.
You're a WITS PhD candidate.
Yes.
So tell me more about that.
As I was saying earlier, my PhD is focusing on the relationship between the media and the state. So I would like to contribute a lot to that area. I have been in the communication space since 1998, but purely by accident, because I didn't study communication at university. My last degree before I could take up a job as a spokesman of a minister was a law degree, so it had nothing to do with communication. So this I had to learn, you know, on the job. And so I thought I could round it off nicely by actually studying this field and making a unique contribution to building these bridges, because I think if we bridge that gap, we are likely to get a better conversation going in the country, and in the end, it will empower people to be able to take advantage of the numerous opportunities that are created by the fact that we are a new nation, growing nation, you know, budding democracy.
Thank you. Thanks for your contribution.
Thank
and thanks
you.
For joining us.
Thank you for inviting me.
That was JJ Tabane on the launch of his new book, Let's Talk Frankly.